I had a failure with some parts that were installed just last week, a favorite old tool died, and how to be popular at parties. That's coming up. Hey, it's Pete. Welcome back to the workshop. Checking a few more things off the punch list this week. Finally got that spindle motor adapter mounted that I 3D printed a couple weeks ago. This is the fifth revision of this part, as you might remember. We had to design this because the original adapter plate had no provisions for mounting the shroud that covers the servo motor. The new adapter plate has tabs that allow mounting for the shroud, as well as providing some scoops to allow airflow. This piece was a good fit, only a little cleanup needed to remove some of the supports that are created for the 3D printing process. I'm hopeful that the next time I remove this pulley, it will be to install a timing belt. Next up on the list was to make a cable to go from the DYN4 encoder output to the Acorn spindle encoder input. This requires three twisted pairs plus a ground and an overall shield. DMM Tech recommended I just use an Ethernet cable to make this up. And this is in lieu of a spindle encoder for the Acorn to regulate the motor speed. If you want to be popular at parties, next time you're with some friends, you should just bring up that this connector is not actually a DB9 connector. Explain to them that even though this is commonly referred to as a DB9, the B actually refers to the case size, so a DB9 connector would actually be the size of a DB25 connector, but would only have 9 pins. This, in fact, is actually a DE9 connector, and nobody calls it that. I'm sure if you share this pedantic knowledge with your friends, you will be incredibly popular with them. The two ends of this connector are wired differently and they aren't reversible, so I need to keep track of which end is which. Next up was providing some way of bringing AC power into the electrical cabinet. Now on the side of the cabinet, there was a knockout for a rectangular connector that actually connected the dynamite electrical cabinet to the transformer that was mounted underneath. We no longer need this, but I figured I could use this hole to do something with. I went back and forth on this several times between trying to decide whether I wanted to install a twist lock connector or just put a strain relief in with a regular piece of wire coming out of it. I borrowed a 2-inch knockout. This is something I don't use nearly enough to warrant owning. There's just enough room to mount this connector beside the automatic lubricator. It left just enough of a lip that I still had room to drill and tap for 8/32 screws. I really wanted to use a twist lock connector, but I really almost couldn't justify the cost of doing that. This is one of those cases where what went through my mind was, okay, I really want the twist lock, and if I don't do it like this in the beginning, I'm probably never going to go back to do it. So I spent the money and I got the twist lock connectors. Wiring the connector is fairly straightforward. The ground, neutral, and hot screws all color-coded with green for ground, white for neutral, and brass for the hot lines. Now, if you're a subscriber, you may have noticed a community post about my heat gun breaking. I took it apart to see if I could fix it, but realized the actual problem was the case itself. The electronics inside are fine, but the case is so brittle and deteriorated that it's no longer holding the internal components in the proper relationship to one another, so it just doesn't work. I looked into getting a new one, but on a whim, I looked up the manufacturer and discovered that they still sell parts for this. I ordered a brand new external shell for this, and it should be here later this week. The serial number, by the way, on this is 288. I don't know if that means second month of 88 or if it's literally number 288. So on to my failure for this week, the stepper motor connectors that I installed last week, they are not going to work. First off, in the comments, a viewer CNC Obsession pointed out that I should have crimped those rather than soldering them. And that's right. I mean, I know that I should have done that, and I don't know why I didn't do that. I have the tool to do that, so I really have no excuse. The deciding factor, though, was that the connectors actually started making a sizzling noise. So I decided, okay, that was that. I'm just going to order crimp-on connectors, and we'll go from there. These are Deutsch connectors that I'm installing. It's a model DTM, which stands for a miniature Deutsch connector. These are somewhat confusing to order. You have to order the pins and the housings and the retainers all separately, unless you're purchasing them in an assortment. I'm really not sure why I didn't do this to begin with. I have the crimping tool, and standing at the machine crimping on connectors was much easier than soldering. This was both better and easier. I will have links to the tools and parts I used down in the video description. Of course, changing the connectors meant I had to pull new wires. I taped a wire to the previous to use as a fish to pull the new wire in. I will need to revisit all these pieces of heat shrink tubing once my gun is repaired. Up to this point, I wasn't completely sure how I was going to handle the incoming AC power. I ended up installing two DIN rail mount fuse holders, one on each hot leg of the incoming 240 volt line. The twist lock connector instructions were on the inside of the box, not really much to know. There were several different wire clamps provided depending on the diameter of cable you use, but the stock gray ones were connect for my cable. Then I just had to run a new wire over for the cable drop. I finished up the last bit of the axis wiring by landing the X, Y, and Z home switches to inputs 1, 2, and 3 on the Acorn. And again, I gotta remember to come back here with this heat gun. The last major hurdle on this retrofit is ahead of me, deciding what to do about external control. I need to decide how I'm going to mount the monitor and keyboard and what, if any, hardwired switches I want to have. Obviously, there'll be an e-stop. I'm just not sure if I want to have other hardwired switches, like say, for instance, a flood coolant override switch. I'd be curious to hear your thoughts in the comments. I have panel mount USB and HDMI connectors. I'm just not completely sure where I'm going to install them. Originally, the idea was that the computer would actually go in the electrical cabinet, and these connectors would then go in the side of the cabinet. But now, I'm not completely sure about that idea, since I have to send 120 volts AC out to the monitor anyways. I'm wondering if I shouldn't just build a box out there that houses the computer, and then all I would really need to send back to this control panel would be an Ethernet cable, and there would be no need for the USB and HDMI expansion connectors in this cable at all. That's something to think about over the coming week. And if you'd like to see another project I've done, click that link to the left and I will catch you over there.